The Bahamas have been a natural laboratory for anole research for more than half a century. The reason is there aren't many places in the world where you can study evolution and ecology in action the way you can on these tiny islands.
What really attracts people to the Bahamas is the just hundreds and thousands of small islands that can be used as experimental units for different studies.
If you get a small enough island that you can study the whole population and yet big enough that they can survive and adapt, it's almost the equivalent of a laboratory test tube, especially because there are lots of islands, and so you can have lots of these test tubes and compare what happens from one island to the next. Research of this sort in the Bahamas began in the 1970s by ecologist Tom Shaner, accompanied by his biologist wife, Amy Shaner. They were interested in species composition, what determines why some islands have more species than others. The problem with studying ecology or evolution on the big islands or even on the mainland is that the ecosystems are too complicated. You might have 10 or more species of anoles living together in one area, plus many other species, including the predators that hunt anoles and the prey that anoles eat. It just gets too complicated. The thing about little islands is that there aren't that many different species. There's just a few species of plants, a few species of insects, so it's much more manageable to study how species interact with one another in the simple environment of these small islands. Research on anoles has shown us that the presence or absence of a single species can have a major effect on the rest of the ecosystem. If you step on an island, you can very quickly know whether there are lizards there or not, simply by the number of spider webs. On islands without lizards, there are spider webs everywhere. But on islands with anoles, the anole population gets very big, it eats up all the spiders. So not many spider webs at all. You might think that'd be good for, say, flies and things like that. But it isn't, because the brown anoles eat the flies too. So general insects also become less abundant in the presence of brown anoles. The element of the ecosystem that benefits from the lizards is the vegetation. The lizards eat all the insects, and the leaves that would get chomped on by the insects are safe. So even though the lizards don't eat the leaves, they may not even touch these leaves, their presence has a positive impact. They get rid of the herbivores, and so the leaves do better. In addition to the interactions between anoles and their prey, we're also interested in competitive interactions between anole species, because in some places, many anole species live side by side. In the Bahamas, we've done experiments where we start with an empty island, and we introduce either the brown anole, which is a trunk ground ecomorph, or the green anole, which is a trunk crown ecomorph, or we put both of them together on the same island. What we found is that the two species do compete, but the brown anole has a much larger effect on the green anole than vice versa. So when the brown anole is present, green anoles are less abundant and they use higher perches than they otherwise would. Small islands are also ideal for studying anole evolution.
One of the coolest things about anoles is their ability to rapidly adapt to new environments. So if the habitat changes or if the climate changes, anoles can adapt very quickly over the course of maybe just a few generations or, you know, several years to decades. A lot of the interesting variation in anoles has to do with the proportions of their limbs. So some species have relatively long limbs, and those species are typically can run quite fast. Other species have shorter limbs, and they're more suited for moving on narrow branches. We conducted an experiment where we introduced brown anoles to islands that they were not occupying. We selected a source population that had very broad vegetation, and we founded seven new islands that had only small diameter vegetation.
We could make predictions about how the species would adapt to these different islands, that on the islands with the narrow vegetation, they should evolve short legs, shorter legs than on the islands with a broader vegetation.
Over the course of about 4 years after that introduction, we followed the hind limb length change that was occurring, And all seven of those populations, the hind limb lengths decrease over that 4-year period. So over the course of just a few generations, we saw a very dramatic response in a key trait, which is consistent with them adapting to those new environmental conditions where you have very narrow vegetation.
One question we often get, and it's usually the pesky botanists who ask us this, is how do we know the differences in limb length are the result of evolutionary change? Because there is another possibility. It may be that the conditions that an individual experiences affect how it grows. Just like if you water a houseplant, it grows more. Maybe it's the case that lizards that grow up using broader surfaces just grow longer legs, that there's no genetic difference at all.
Brown anoles are interesting in that when you raise hatchling lizards on different diameter substrates, they do have significantly different limbs relative to their body size. Hatchlings that are raised on very narrow substrates have shorter limbs than hatchlings that are raised on broader substrates.
It turns out that lizards can change in response to the environment they experience during their lifetime. We call this process phenotypic plasticity. But in anoles, this effect is pretty small. Phenotypic plasticity may contribute a little bit to the changes in leg length we've observed, but the primary driver is natural selection producing evolutionary change. A lot of people think of evolution as a slow, gradual process, and that's actually what Darwin thought too. So with the anoles, it's been amazing to observe evolutionary changes in leg length in just a few short years. Once we realized that anoles would adapt rapidly to new conditions, it sets the stage for even larger experiments that allow us to test how both predation and competition affect the whole ecosystem and how they influence the evolution of species within that ecosystem.